I told my husband I was going to use this song, he goes, "You're going to sing it?" I said, "No, not when we all know Julie Andrews. Never, never." Well, it will make sense why I've picked that little spot there on film. But let's first pray. Gracious God, we give you thanks for today, the opportunity to gather to praise your name. You are God for whom no path is untraveled, no person unknown. We go at your bidding to encounter new things, to embrace new people, and to bless all those we meet along the way. Amen. Grace and peace to you from our Lord and Savior Jesus the Christ. The reason why I showed you that, I know it wasn't the best quality, it was taped from someone's tape kind of thing, but to get the idea that what's been going on in Genesis 1 through 11, today we're in Genesis 12, has been the cosmic story, like those gigantic hills and mountains, and that story of God's creation, and then the story of how sin came into the world through Adam and Eve and Cain and Abel and the Tower of Babel and Noah's Ark, and how God responded to God's people. Now the camera comes from the sky and pans down, if you will, to one person named Abram and his wife Sarah. We will come to know them as Abraham and Sarah. And in chapter 12, God is doing something new. He is making another commitment to God's people. But instead of that great cosmic vista, he is zooming in on one couple, and he is going to bless them so that they will be a blessing. Why Abram and Sarah? The call comes out of nowhere. And the text makes no attempt to explain why them. But our great, 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 great grandparents, 100 times over, Sarai and Abram in the faith, were called by God to go. And they went. Abram doesn't offer excuses like, "God, Sarah and I are pretty comfortable. And you know, God, it really doesn't fit into our retirement plan." Or, "Hey God, it is not at all one of my long-term goals." Or, "I'm tired, God. I don't want to go anywhere." The few verses in chapter 12 begin to shape and give a foundation for so much of what will come in the Old Testament. God calls three promises, a threefold promise. First, land. "I will promise you land." Secondly, descendants. Now, we heard in the text that Sarai is barren. This is not, it's setting up a tension here. How can these old people, they're older, how can they be having babies at that age, especially when they've been told that she's barren? And finally, the third is blessing. Being called is not always easy. And there will be more than one instance that will come in Genesis and in the rest of the Old Testament where Abraham's descendants will say, "Lord, if this is what it looks like to be blessed, I'm really glad you didn't choose me to be cursed," because of the struggles and challenges that life can bring. Or my favorite musical, hands down, is Fiddler on the Roof. As Tevye puts it, "Lord, can't you choose another people to be blessed for a while?" As he's preparing to move his family because of an edict of the Russian Tsar, which will evict all the Jews from the town of Anatevka. I love the line, and I think I remember it correctly, where Tevye says to his neighbor, "I'm moving to New York." And the neighbor says, "I'm moving to Chicago." And Tevye says, we're going to be neighbors. They did not know where the journey would take them. And neither did Abram and Sarai. God said, go to a land where I will show you. Now, it's interesting that God is calling them to a new place, a place where they will belong. I mean, they've been living decades upon decades upon decades in the place that they came from. And that's not where they belonged? Is belonging just about real estate? Or is it something deeper? Is somehow belonging trusting God on the journey? God's call to Abram and Sarai essentially is to leave home, family, nationality even, to trust this God who has called them to go. It is not convenient, and it takes Abram and Sarai out of their comfort zone. And let's face it, it doesn't make sense. A journey based on trust that takes faith, that's kind of what our lives are about, right? As Christ followers called Christians, that it doesn't always make sense. It's not always convenient. And sometimes that faith takes us out of our comfort zone. Many of us would prefer a very clear direction, using a GPS to say, this is my destination and these are the stops along the way. Well, what is our final destination as Christians? Is of course to be with our Lord in his heavenly kingdom. But what happens between birth and death? We call that time the dash. The dash between your birth date and your death date. So what does that life of faith look like as you live your dash? The in-between. As God has called us out of the baptismal waters, as God calls Alexi today, to go, to be my servant in the world by what you say and by what you do. And trust in God's presence is what Abram did. Well, at least most of the time. If you read the whole Abraham narrative, Abram was far from perfect. There are numerous stories where he attempts to take a shortcut or he relies on his own understanding, and there are consequences because of it. There are pitfalls, just like life for us, because we too are not perfect. The call of Abraham ultimately becomes a call to the whole Old Testament, to God's people, to the Hebrew people, then called the Israelites, then called the Jews, and eventually a call to the church. 13 years ago, this past summer, I interviewed here at Holy Cross. And we had a full interview day, and the morning after Paul and I left for another possible call, opportunity in North Carolina, St. Andrews in New Bern, North Carolina. I bet you've heard that town on the news these days, because this morning they will not be able to worship. Their community has experienced historic flooding because of the hurricane, and their building is not able to be used at this time. Over 400 people were rescued yesterday. And, you know, sometimes you wonder, why don't those people leave when they say leave? And then it dawns on you. Not everyone has the means to be able to pick up and leave. Most of the people that are rescued are poor. Most of them are elderly. Most of them are disabled. Or they just don't have the financial or the community to go to when they are in need of refuge. And some, they don't leave because they have nowhere to take their pets with them. I heard in the news that over 4,200 homes were destroyed in New Bern alone. 13 years ago, I sat in their sanctuary, and as we were worshiping, I wondered, God, is this where you're calling us to be? I mean, the church had these huge plate glass windows, and it overlooked a busy street, and across the road was a neighborhood that was falling apart because of the ravages of poverty. As the pastor preached, this forlorn-looking man walked upon the sidewalk, pushing a grocery cart with what I could only imagine was all his worldly possessions. My first impulse was to say, man, that's really distracting. I'm trying to worship here. And then I thought, I wonder what that man thinks of us worshiping in our Sunday finest. And then it was like the Holy Spirit kind of slapped me upside the head and said, Meredith, that's the world that you are called to serve. That's the world the church is called to serve. Maybe that's why churches have hard pews. It's because we're not supposed to be comfortable. This is a place we gather, but it is not a place to stay, because then we scatter to do God's work. Yeah, I realize sitting there that I wasn't called to this place, but to that hot, muggy, historical, coastal city, I really felt like I had my Midwestern pastor hat on, and my heart, quite frankly, was already committed to this place. So today, I've been thinking about them a lot. I'm so grateful that I can go home and watch a football game and don't have to deal with a flooded church building and most likely a congregation full of people who have lost their homes, or at least many belongings. But I know I will be there through my gift to Lutheran Disaster Relief. I know that our larger church, the ELCA, will go there and will do ministry on our behalf, 100% of all donations directly to CARE. And when our church goes, they are the last to leave. All the cameras will go away, the Red Cross will go away, all the other agencies, but the ELCA disaster people will still be present for years to come. We need to put our thoughts and prayers into action, and we need to go. And sometimes that's through our financial gifts. I was looking at St. Andrew's website yesterday, and I looked in the sanctuary, and those clear plate glass windows were now replaced with these beautiful stained glass windows. Beautiful windows. But I thought, they can't see out to that mission field anymore. And neither can we as we gaze upon our beautiful windows. But the world goes by all the same. And the church, this church, is called to go. We are not to be a comfortable club where members get benefits and privileges. Rather, it is a greater responsibility to be a member and to hear the call of God. We are, as our mission statement proclaims, we are to grow in faith and serve the Lord. And just in case you thought that was for young people, the story of Abram and Sarai reminds us, God isn't finished with you yet. If you are over the age of 65, and if we can't physically go out into the world, we lift up those who do in our prayers. We lift them up with our offerings through the greater church for missionaries and all peacekeepers and things like that. We leave a part of our financial legacy to Holy Cross so that the ministry can continue after our dash here on earth is done. The mission of God's work continues to happen. Today, our church went through the three people that heard the call to go to Tanzania, Amanda and Stephanie and Tracy. It wasn't necessarily convenient. It was like a 24-hour journey, but the call was heard nonetheless. And we give thanks that we will be blessed by their time. Go, says God, and may we hear God's call. So now I end with a provocative question. I chose not to go here in my sermon today, but I invite you to ponder this question as you leave. God said to Abram and Sarai, I will make of you a great nation, and I will bless you and make your name great, that you will be a blessing. I will bless you so that you may be a blessing. I will make of you a great nation. So my questions for you are, what does it mean to be blessed, to be a blessing? How do we respond? And what does it mean to be a great nation? Amen. Let's pray. Oh God, you have called your servants to ventures of which we cannot see the ending, by paths as yet untrodden, through perils unknown. Give us faith to go out with good courage, not knowing where we go, but only that your hand is leading us and your love supporting us, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.